This is going to be another very intense video because of the tremendous breakthroughs that happened today. So, as you listen, so shall you hear. How you listen is all important, so I want to give you time to settle in here. Very intense information. The better you listen, the more clear it will be. There's an art to listening, actually. And I try to practice that during the day and listen, and then pass on the clarity that arrived today. So we adjust and let our preparation get ready for some sort of ordeal. What I have found is this all-out effort is yielding fruit now, Even the most difficult realizations now are, I'm starting to glimpse them. Just a glimpse, but a glimpse is enough, actually, to keep you really going forward and saying, wow, it really is that way, wow. Hey, these teachers really are telling us the truth. Wow. Now, it's amazing because some of these glimpses, what I'm seeing, it is so amazing. And this is what the teachers have been telling us, and we just, like, it boggles our mind. What are they saying? You know, what are they really saying? I don't get it. You know, once you get it, you see it, say, oh, that's what they were saying. Oh, I see. Wow. I didn't realize just how completely radical it is. You know, what it's just, it's so, it requires just tremendous momentum to see it, to get it. I mean, they say, well, I'll tell you what, there is no form. There is no form. No such thing as form. That's a fact. This is what the teachers have said. And today I realized that what they're talking about, said, wow, you've heard like the no thingness. There are no things, meaning there is no such thing as form. Form does not exist. That is a fact. Form does not exist. Now, you hear a teaching like that, and you just say, I just don't have a clue what they're talking about, right? There's only appearance. There's only appearance. Okay, now how in the world is it possible to recognize that there really is no such thing as form? In fact, form is impossible. Form is impossible. There will never, ever, ever, ever be any form whatsoever. So this gets right up the alley of Guru Longchenpa and Jesus Christ. This is what they're saying. And there have been other teachers, of course. This is just what they're saying. And now I'm agreeing with them. I'm saying, hey, you know, I get what you're saying. That's great. Now, it's not some full-blown realization, it's a glimpse. But a glimpse is enough to get in the club, you know, to say, hey, I like hanging out with you. I like being in this club, so I agree with what they're saying. Now, how do we get there? How do we get to such a... something that seems to us to be utter nonsense? We take form to be reality, or at least we take form to be a fact. It is not a fact. It is not a fact at all. do we explain this? So you can understand how this video is immediately in very intense content. No such thing as form. In order to get this, you have to have a sort of an overall contextual understanding and acceptance of the whole basis of this arising of this appearance we call the world, we call form. It's mere appearance, actually. But it is mere appearance which is supposed to give the impression of form. The impression of form. As if form was real. Like a mirage of form, like something that's solid, permanent there. Okay, Jesus calls the world, the universe, a mirage. Longjumpa, the same basic descriptions is, it is a mirage, it is an illusion, it is a hallucination, it's a mirage. In mirage, you think you see a city there, a solid city, that has stability and form and everything to it. And as you drive to the mirage, it just, you know, it just vanishes. It was never there. It was never there. This is just an analogy that they use. But we can get much more exact than this. We must realize what this world is. Where did this world come from? We call it a world. Actually, there is no world. It's just an appearance. We think of the world as all these things. All these forms, a collection of forms. There are no forms. There are no bodies. There are no forms. There are no things. There are no worlds. And hence, there really isn't a universe. And there most certainly is not time and space. Okay. So all of this became clear to me today. And, you know, this is okay. That's good. Another day of struggling away here. And, our troubles, this illusion, this trouble we have began when we tried to be separate from God, to be greater than God, to be prime creator, replace God as prime creator. This led to viewing reality as if it were utter chaos, endless utter chaos. And I won't struggle with why that reaction occurs, but it does. And even though reality is not chaos, when we're trying to see a lack of oneness in reality, okay, a lack of oneness, it's not one because we think we're separate. So a lack of oneness, we can't find it. So everything we always see is this picture of total chaos, which gives the impression of, I can't find it because of this chaos, but it must be there somewhere. Well, this chaos is completely unacceptable to spirit, mind. And so there's this tremendous reaction to escape from this chaos, this picture of chaos, and to somehow figure to solve it. Well, now, many, 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 many aspects of spirit have tried this whimsical impetuosity of trying to be greater than God, and this, or what arises is this experiencing of utter chaos, which is completely non-experienceable, actually. We immediately say, wow, I gotta just get away from that immediately. So there's been this vast collection of aspects of spirit. Call them rebellious, whimsical, impetuous, misadventure. This misadventure, many aspects of spirit has gone on this misadventure, saying, hey, I wonder what it'd be like if we are greater than God. Let's see, that's a misadventure. So all these aspects of spirit got together and they all agreed, hey, this chaos is non-experienceable, so we can't really experience being greater than God. What are we going to do? And through a collective effort of desire, what we desire is, okay, so collective effort of desire, we're part of this, we set up some parameters for desire, saying we must In order to escape this, solve this problem of this chaos, we must desire. What? You see, is the question. There was an agreement. There was a collaboration. And in fact, this agreement and this collaboration has been going on for untold moments, you know, just continually working at this to agree on certain parameters of appearance, where appearance we would all agree that these are the appearances, that the appearances will follow these certain parameters, will be within these certain parameters. What parameters? Time and space, time and space, time and space. Which are invented notions, actually. But we agreed to give the impression of form, time, and space through a collective agreement of following parameters for appearance. For instance, the tree is rooted right in your yard, outside your window, and we all agree that this is going to stay rooted there. It's not going to suddenly shift across the street because you desire it. That we're going to say that there are certain parameters of appearance that we're going to accept have a certain location in space. Also, maybe there's a small little tree. Well, there's a big tree, let's say, and this big tree is not suddenly going to shrink down to a little sapling, you know, right? We've agreed that in something we call growth or duration, evidence of duration called time. So we have agreed to put all appearances as if there were time, duration, and location. Duration and location. Time and space. And that we do not desire other than that. You see? We agree to not desire other than that. It's simply an agreement with no binding power whatsoever. It is simply an agreement in order to try and solve this problem of this utter chaos, endless chaos, so we can enjoy and experience and enjoy being greater than God. And we think that together we can do this if we just agree to these parameters of appearance. Okay, so when we have something agree upon appearance that has duration, and an appearance that has location, and we're not shifting, changing that, we agreed not to desire other than that, then we can interpret it and claim that there's form there, that there's process there, that there's something called process, which doesn't exist actually. Neither does time, neither does space, neither does form. All of this, process, time, space, form, this is the matrix of agreement that all these spirits that who are on this misadventure have agreed upon as seemingly offering a way to try and resolve this problem of utter chaos. And yet, none of that is binding in the slightest bit to any aspect of spirit, not even in the slightest bit. It is totally, it's a totally non-binding agreement. But in order to think that possible we can resolve this problem of chaos, we feel we need to accept this agreement and come into a place like we come into what we call this world, this the area of this agreement where appearances are based on these parameters, this matrix agreement, and have our experiencing be bound by that agreement. So we think we're a body in a world, and everything has duration and location, which it actually does not. Everything is mere appearance here. Everything is mere appearance, completely subject to our desire of what we want to experience. Now, I had a very interesting experience today. I was at the dump, and unloading some trash there. And this pickup truck was about 30 feet away from me. And they were digging into this huge load of dusty, you know, dirt, just dirt with all this dust, and the wind was blowing. And so the wind was blowing this dust right into my face, and I'm working there, and I'm just eating this dust, you know. I just said, wow. I said, well, okay, you know, it's a dump, what can I do? And I thought, you know what, why don't I pray that the wind shifts? Can't hurt, right? Why not? So I tried the prayer. Well, you know what happened? The wind did shift, but it got even worse and blew all the whole load of dust. It got even worse. And I said, wow, so much for prayer, you know. It got worse. And I said, well, why did it get worse? Why did it get worse? That is so strange. And then I said, you know what? I wonder if the matrix agreement, this collective consciousness, which is just an agreement, I wonder if that takes offense at you trying to change, you know, the parameters of the agreement, saying, hey, no, I don't like the wind, the way the wind's coming, so I want it to change. Maybe they say, hey, who are you to try and change that? We'll make it even worse for you if you pray that way, okay? And I was thinking, wow, this is very interesting. And then a thought popped into my mind, and I said, hey, why don't I pray in Jesus' name? So I said, okay, it's worth a try. So I prayed in Jesus. I said, I asked the wind to shift direction, and I said, I pray this prayer in Jesus' name. What happened? What happened is the wind shifted away from me. It shifted away from me, and no more dust. I just noticed it. I said, very interesting. Very interesting. Now, the clarity started coming. I said, hey, wait a minute. I wonder why, if that's the basis for people praying in Jesus' name, Val, saying that it's very important to do that. And I had an insight into this, and I said, you know what? Jesus represents spirit that is not agreeing with these agreements of this matrix of time and space and form and process. Jesus does not agree with any of that. In fact, he says that's all an illusion, a mirage, just an agreement. There's no binding power whatsoever to any of this. And repent, repent, repent. You don't need it. Repent and you don't need it. So when you pray to the matrix, you know, you're just as liable. It's liable to maybe it'll grant your request a little bit, or it will actually say, hey, you know, how arrogant of you to think that you can control the wind, the direction of the breeze. That's impossible. This is process. You know, this is time, space, location, form, process. You can't do that. How dare you? And you may get things worse. So instead, say, hey, I'm saying a prayer, but I'm asking Jesus. Say, Jesus, you shift the wind for me. Not this collection of misadventuring spirits. These misadventuring spirits, this collection, who are all agreeing, you can't do that. That can't be done. You don't have the power to do that. I say, Jesus, you know that you have the power to do that, that I have the power to do that. We all have the power to do that. Whatever we desire is. So I'm asking on my behalf for you to do this, because you know we all have this power. There is no binding force in any of this quote-unquote nature. There is no nature at all. That's another thing. There's no body, there's no form, there's no time, there's no space, there's no process, there's no nature, there's no world, there's no universe. None whatsoever. And I said, Jesus, you know this is true. This is a fact, and I know that you know it's true. So I pray in your name for you to do this, not the matrix. And the wind shifted. The wind shifted very quickly. I said, wow, don't have to eat that dust anymore. Not, you know, just enough of a shift, a subtle shift, just enough so the dust was missing me now. Just enough. Wasn't some whirlwind coming down, but a subtle enough shift. And I say, I wonder if that isn't a miracle right there, that this isn't what Jesus is talking about. Miracles is subtle little shifts, very subtle little shifts. We pray in Jesus' name. and understanding what we're talking about. Not just words, but hey, I pray in Jesus' name, the one who agreeing upon. It's not agreement whatsoever in any of those. He certainly acknowledges that we're doing that, understands what why we're doing, etc., but is not in agreement at all. That's why when Jesus came to this world, they said, hey, this is your kingdom, welcome, Messiah. And he said, no, this is not my kingdom. And when he left, they said, where are you going? He said, I'm going to my Father's kingdom. This is not my kingdom here. Not at all. I don't agree with these parameters at all. Resurrected his body, saying, look, I'm not going to go, I'm proving to you, I'm not agreeing with your parameters. This is completely arbitrary. No binding power whatsoever. You kill the body, I'll raise it right up again. Just an appearance. Mere appearance. Completely unbound. There are no laws or forces other than my desire to experience. My desire for experiencing is. Whatever I desire to experience is. That's the only law there is. So for sure Jesus does not agree with these agreements. The resurrection proved that, right? Absolutely proved it. Yeah, his body was crushed and beaten, and so, you know, here's his resurrected body, and he's perfectly fine. Perfectly fine. No trouble at all. All an appearance. Nothing more than an appearance. All of this is simply an appearance, meaning it is absolutely not bound at all to location, to duration, right? To thingness, to formness. The idea of a form is that an appearance has duration. If there's no duration, how can you say it's a form? Now we say, but look, I see this table. It's look at all this duration. That's an agreement that we have to see it as duration. To keep seeing the same appearance moment by moment by moment. We agree to allow this what we call a process of nature, which we have agreed upon, to slowly change, appearances change very slowly, as if they had some sort of duration, even though they don't. We could look at this table, and we could have it turn into a garden instantly, you know, turn into a swimming pool or something. There is no true solidity, true duration to anything whatsoever. All of this is just a mere appearance. Any instant, anything in the entire universe could be anything else or nothing at all. Every single instant. So there's no such thing as form. There's no such thing as duration at all. Anything can appear anywhere. There's no such thing as location, locational space at all. There's pure spaciousness, everything arises in, but no such thing as locational spaciousness. So how can you say there's a world? How can you even say there's a universe? How can you say there's a body? You cannot. It is all just light. It's all just the appearance of light. So all of this became self-evident today. It was just self-evident. I just said, oh, yeah. I see what they're talking about. Very interesting. Now, everything still looks solid and like form for me. That's no problem. It's just getting a glimpse of this and you realize this is most certainly true. Most certainly true. So you can see that there is an enlightened perspective. There is a perspective that is quite different than what we're used to. And it simply means freeing ourselves from all these agreements. And how do we do that? Well, there is no binding power to any of these agreements. But there is this frantic fear from those who have entered into this agreement that if we don't maintain this agreement, we're going to be, you know, be stuck with endless chaos. Not only that, even more scary is we'll be suddenly realized there isn't, everything is perfect. There never was any chaos. Everything has always been exactly the way it is right now. Perfect, absolutely perfect. And pure happiness. And we're terrified of that. We're not ready for it. That's the continuity problem. So we all have this dreadful continuity fear. And so we keep agreeing. Oh yeah, sure, this, you know, my life. Now, if another thing that Jesus says, if you see someone else as a body, you're making your own death. You're bringing death upon yourself now. Okay, I saw that today also. I saw a lot today. If you think that there is some body there, meaning a form, that means that form is possible. That means your body's a form too, actually. And that form will certainly pass away. You're creating your own death by this, and this got very clear. This has to be explained more clearly, though, there's no question about it. Now, if you're just an appearance, this body is just an appearance, how can it die? It's not a form, it has no duration, has no location. Nothing can happen to it. It's like Jesus' body is laid in the grave, and he says, okay, I'm just going to, now the body's going to be walking around. There was an appearance of a body in a grave, now there's an appearance of a body walking around. So, what is death to that? To that? What is death? So it doesn't exist, does it? Because you could just easily say, I don't have the body just appear to be walking around all the time. It's a mere appearance. Nothing can hurt appearance at all. If you desire for this appearance, then nothing, you can't do it. No spirit can do anything. No spirit has the power to interfere with the experiencing of another spirit. So this is just everything, just a mere appearance. There can't possibly be any such thing as death. Death is supposed to be the end of a process. There is no process. Death is supposed to be the end of a form. There are no forms. Now, if you insist that there are these bodies, you see some other body and say, no, you are a body. You have a body. Instead of this is mere appearance that they are not bound to in the slightest bit. You're entering into that agreement of seeing form and process and time and location and space, and no, and you most certainly will not escape from that. You will see yourself also as bound by process, time, space, form. And you will then fear the dissolution of that form. The end of duration, location. You'll think it's a loss of identity. You feel that you're not going to have a completeness. If you feel that you need to be complete, as if all of this time, form, process, space was needed to somehow complete what you are. Here's the truth, that we don't need anything to be complete. We as spirit, pure awareness, are created complete, created perfect. Pure awareness, what does pure awareness need to be complete? Well, you might say it needs experiencing. Okay, fine. But there's no particular specific appearance that it needs. It only needs this creativity. It needs to be creative, sure. That's how it was created. But it has complete freedom as far as how that creativity plays. So there's never, ever anything specified, any experience specified whatsoever. So there cannot possibly be anything defined as needed for completion. And so all of this stuff seems like incredibly difficult to get, and yet here it is, I'm getting all of this now. So how is that possible? Well, you've seen on these videos, you see the constant work at it, the determination, everyday determination is how you get there. What happens is you build up momentum. You build up momentum. And so all of the listening the right way with full stop, don't allow, you know, it to be fragmented, the information to be fragmented. Don't allow it to be, just allow it to be as it is. information. Just allow it to be as it is. Don't try to do anything other than that. Just let it be what it is. Then you yourself are practicing that it's okay to just be, and all as it is, experiencing as it is, my desired experience is, that is the experiencing. Then you actually get momentum towards this, and it's not frightening or scary at all. That's why the good teachers tell us, you, in order to have a successful path, you have to build up momentum. Your progress must be brisk. The greatest expert on spiritual paths I'm aware of is Sri Sri Anandamayi, the greatest expert. She went through what's called a Leela of Sadhana in Bajetpur, which is now Bangladesh. Back then it was East Bengal. And she decided, what would it be like to play the role of the guru and the devotee simultaneously? And to work, she put herself through spiritual paths as both the aspirant and also the guru, giving initiation and guidance to the aspirant, all simultaneously. I've never heard of anything like this before. And this went on for several years, I believe, in Bajetpur. And during this time, she traversed innumerable spiritual paths from the beginning all the way to the end of the path. And she said, what takes you a lifetime, I do in a matter of seconds, actually. And so she was able to just, she said she traversed innumerable spiritual paths. And so she actually then, she said she had actual this experiential knowing, as it were, of all these paths. So anybody who came in contact with her, she knew their spiritual path exactly how it goes and what advice to give them on the spiritual path. But she did give out some general explanations to everyone, and that is, the progress on your path must be brisk. You must build up momentum. You must go, you know, rapidly. You must really push it. This is generalized instructions for all paths, actually. So she gave out both generalized instructions and individual instructions, which were specific to each path that somebody was on. There are many, many paths, especially in that area, India and Tibet and the whole Buddhist Hindu conglomeration there throughout the ages. And there's just, you know, a whole lot of different ways that they've come up with. And she knew them all personally by actually traversing them. It's called the Leela of Sadhana in Bajetpur, in Bangladesh now. Living in a little hut there, a little house, and she'd just go, you know, go through all these paths with the different reactions, and it's just amazing, just absolutely amazing. It is just incredible beyond belief, actually. The upshot is, she says, look, you got to go fast. You have to build momentum. You have to put even more effort into it. And you have to sort of break the inertia. Keep breaking the inertia, break the inertia, break the inertia. And wear it away. I call it evaporating the continuity fear. Evaporate more and more, more and more, more heat. Otherwise, she says, you'll come up short. And this is from direct experience, okay, with innumerable paths. She says, you'll come up short unless you do that. So, you know, I took this, you know, to heart. I said, wow, I gotta believe this is true. So I've been putting this great effort forward to just, you know, absolutely push. I pushed it so much that I was on the verge of death, actually, recently. Just could hardly function at all. It was just an all-out effort to succeed. Well, I didn't quite succeed, but now I'm starting to, you know, I've made it through that, and I'm still functional, and the insights are coming very rapidly now. The glimpses, keep in mind, you only need to glimpse something just for an instant, just a glimpse, just enough to see it and say, ah, okay, it's there, I get it. And then, of course, the agreements that everyone demands here, you know, closes in. It's like you will crack the door open and you see, ah, I see the light. Okay, just pretend like nothing happened to people, you know, the world. The agreements here. And I don't know what's going to happen next. I don't know how it plays out. But I'm sure that, well, provided I keep going. And asking in Jesus' name that I do keep going, the miracles, I keep going. In other words, I'm asking first that spirit which represents reality. I'm asking for help from that source, not from the matrix source, okay? Very important, do not ask help from the matrix source. The collective consciousness. Do not ask help from the collective consciousness that is giving rise to this belief in time, space, process, form, world, body. Do not ask help from that source. That won't work. That is why in Christianity, of course, you see the ask prayers as always. We ask this prayer in Jesus' name. That is very important. And I didn't realize that until today, just several hours ago. It is extraordinarily important. And of course, this collective consciousness doesn't like that. There's a lot of stuff it doesn't like. It doesn't like anything. It doesn't like truth. It doesn't like truth. It hates truth. Because the truth is, there is no binding agreement. There is no form. There is no time, there is no space, there is no process at all. That's the truth. And so they say, well, there's no way to cure this problem of endless chaos. And I say, absolutely, yes, there is. Wait a minute, yes, there is. Repent. Repent, meaning change what you desire. And that cures it right there. And they say, well, I just don't feel comfortable with that. Well, that's called the continuity fear, which means you've got to go on a spiritual path of evaporating this continuity fear. You got no choice, you have to do it. And that's another thing Sri Anandamayi Ma said, is the spiritual path is like medicine that you have to take it. You have to take it. There's no way around it. You know, these heavyweight teachers tell you the truth, and sometimes it sounds very harsh. And I've just gotten used to this, you know, throughout my whole life, listening to them. It's still harsh. It's like, wow, that's really strong medicine you're saying, wow. But it gets into you, it gets into you, and you know, gradually, you know, your unwillingness, you gradually evaporate it. Your rebelliousness gradually evaporates. Now, there's two types of people. There's those who've repented, and then those who are rebellious spirits who are still rebelling against God, still rebelling against truth. And they say, no, we don't need to repent. We just need to keep on with this agreement. We're just going to work. I think it's going to work for us. You know? So they're going to keep believing in form, which is death. It's death. And I'll get into that at some point. I'll explain it to you a little more. I'll let that sink in some more. So don't struggle with it. You know, I'm feeling a little struggle right there. Okay, so you just drop it. Rebellious spirits. And there's a lot of those in this world. They say, we're not going to take any medicine at all. Well, they're going to then continue on with their misery. Which we call hell. This collective agreement of how to parameters of appearance, which we call the matrix, which is really hell. It's a place of Buddhist what samsara. It really is samsara. It really is hell. It really is illusion, as Jesus says. It really is suffering. It really is misery. So to continue on with it is absolute folly. Absolute folly. The only problem we have is the continuity problem. There is no other problem. There is no other problem but the continuity problem. And that can be dealt with. That can be dealt with. So, all of these meditations, all these intensives are bearing fruit now. I hope that they would. And again, it's just glimpses. But, wow. You know, just to glimpse it and say, hey, you know, I believe I can get this. Yeah. There's no such thing as form. There's never been any form ever, and there never will be. Form doesn't exist. Therefore, process does not exist. Therefore, time does not exist. Therefore, space does not exist. Right? We are free. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me to be. We are all not bodies. We are free. We are all still spirit, exactly as God created us all to be. So this world is a very intense illusion, actually. A very intense illusion designed to turn you away from reality. Designed to make you think that reality has changed. Designed to actually try to lead you into oblivion, being oblivious of your true functioning, to be oblivious of reality. If we believe in time, space, process, form, if we believe in that, we have truly turned our back on reality. And we're truly trying to cultivate absolute oblivion to what we are. No question about it. So, that's why Jesus said this world is hell. This world is the kingdom of darkness, ruled over by the prince of darkness. He says, this is not my kingdom. I'm not staying here. This is not my kingdom. I came to bring a sword here to divide the wheat from the chaff, wheat and the tares, to divide the repentant from the still rebellious and prideful spirits here. I came to bring a decision, a sword of decision. I didn't come to bring peace in this world. I came to bring the sword of decision here. You have to decide when, you know, are you going to repent or not? Now, what happens to those who don't repent? They continue on with their collective agreement, you know, agreement of process, form, time, space, this agreement, and they'll continue on with the misery, suffering, death, believing that they're going to die. They die. When these so-called form dies, they're dead. There's never any form at all. There's actually never any death at all. There's never been any death at all. Never. Nothing has ever died. Why? There haven't been any things to die. Nothing has ever died because there are no things. There's never been any things. There's no such thing. There's no death in reality. There are no things. There's only now. There's only here now. Here, everywhere. Everywhere is here. All and everywhere is here now. Whatever we desire to experience is. Whatever we desire to experience is, that's the only law of reality there is. Whatever we desire to experience is. And is, and is, and is, and is, and is. There's nothing else to enter in that equation. Nothing else enters into it. Last night, I had a hideous night. I've been not been able to sleep for a long time now. And last night was just the worst, you know. And I decided, you know what, I'm not going to sink. I'm not going to go down the ship. Because I was feeling like, I don't think I'm going to make it. And I said, no, I'm going to make it. And so what I started to do is I allowed the body to release all sorts of tension through just shaking movements, all sorts of. I allowed the mouth just, and it seemed like I just relaxed all this like tension to move and speak and breathe in a certain way. All of that was released. I was just shaking and trembling all over, and just I was aware of it. I've done this before, and just allowing it to take place, and you'd be amazed at how much coercive movement is stored in your nervous system. telling you what to say, how to, where to go, all the stuff from this matrix, actually. And so if you are lying in bed and you just you feel like your foot is, your ankle's twitching, just let it twitch and just let it go like this. And you'll find it may go like for 10 minutes like this, and then finally it's enough. And you're like, wow, you know, all of that was stored up as demands from this matrix to function in accordance with this agreement, which you're not really bound to at all. And I found after this, I suddenly felt rejuvenated. And I've had a decent day, amazingly, miraculously so. And all this clarity has suddenly arisen. And I'm able to say things I wasn't able to say before. I was able to act in ways I wasn't able to act before. I was able to turn away from the world, from rebellious spirits. I was able to say, you know what? This is what needs to be done here in this world. And so I have way more freedom of expression, of thought, everything, by just allowing sort of this body to release all its the demand that your body act in a certain way, your speech be a certain words. I found tremendous amount of release through my whole speech apparatus. I never experienced that before. And, you know, just as if like thousands, you know, words and so much saying just was all being released without saying anything. It was just all gone. And now it's like I feel I'm able to speak about various subjects much more easily, more clearly. So the tremendous release of all this bullyingness that we're being bullied in this world to go along with all these agreements and even to be oblivious of them and not question them at all and not comment on them at all and not move about the world and say anything about them at all. And so what I was having was that the pressure on me was so severe I almost died. I was in such bad shape and felt feeling so tense and literally like I can't move hardly. Because the demand here is that you don't ever question any of this. To do so is heresy. It's blasphemy. It's heresy. It's hatred. Is you know, just you just completely taboo. Completely taboo. But Jesus tells us, no, we're supposed to question all this. Hermana says we're supposed to inquire. Okay. Sri Sri Nanda Maima says we're supposed to, our whole responsibility in life, our sole responsibility is the spiritual path of digging into this, of inquiring upon all this. Is there time, space, form, and process or not? Or is it merely a collective agreement to desire for this, to continually desire for what we call nature? We're not bound by anything we desire. There is nothing we can ever desire to experience. There is nothing that we can experience that we can ever be bound by. No experience can ever bind us. That is what we are. We are unbindable. We are unbindable. And yet, Spirit is agreeing to pretend to be bound by nature. Nature is a fiction. It's a myth. Nature doesn't exist. It's never existed and never will exist. There's no such thing as nature. Now, again, how do you get the momentum to get to this clarity? I've had to put forth an astonishing effort. And it seemed all the more difficult because it's like almost like a vacuum here, a pagan vacuum. I call the rebellious spirits, you know, pagans, really. And you know, pagans love to flout their sensuality, their body. There's all these, you know, pagan attitudes and stuff. And they say, hey, I should be able to do whatever I want to do here. It's my life. I'm not, you know, why should you care what I do? Well, because their attitude is denial of reality, and they can be very forceful in their expressions. They can be very forceful in demanding that you see them as a body, demanding that you're bound to that, demanding that that seeing them as a body is actually pleasurable for you. That's actually what you want to experience. All the while binding you to your belief in death is what they're actually doing. It's a death game. The pagans are involved in death, the game of death, actually. So when we say, well, they say, well, we should be able to do whatever we want to do. Really? Well, shouldn't then we be able to do whatever we want to do? Should we then scrap all these agreements? Right? Say, I'm not a body. I'm just an appearance. You can't kill me. You can't do anything to me. Shouldn't I be free to do that? That's what Jesus did. And the pagans say, no, you can't do that. You can't do that. We got to be able to kill you. So, you see, it's not fair. They don't play, it's not, there's no, right? They say, no, we want to be able to do whatever we want to do, but you can't. Now, ultimately, truth is true, and you can't change it. So the pagans have no choice, the rebellious spirits have no choice but to repent and then evaporate the continuity fear and spend a lifetime working on this. There's no choice about that whatsoever. So, fairness doesn't exist. Only truth exists. Fairness means two sides. There aren't any two sides to reality. What we desire to experience is, merely is, and that's it. There are no two sides to that. So, our responsibility in this world is repentance and to work on the continuity fear, the spiritual path. That is everyone's responsibility. So the pagans are flat out wrong, and they do not have the right to insist upon, well, I should be able to do this whatever I want to do. Well, they're spreading death, the belief in death, and they're spreading lies and deceit and insisting and demanding that you believe in what doesn't exist, and that pulls you down into continual misery. They don't have the right to do that. There's no absolute right to do that whatsoever. Certainly not to keep you from, you know, your path. And since they're just simply avoiding their responsibility, they have no choice but to repent. It's absolutely right and just for the world to insist that the world needs to get about its business. This is the only business there is in any world, quote unquote world. So if the pagans want to go to someplace else, let them go. Or if it happens that they take over this planet, then we'll go somewhere else. Okay, but that somewhere else is dedicated to our one responsibility, to our taking care of business. And I've proven to myself that taking care of business works, because you do see through this massive deception. You can see through it. Absolutely, you can. That the teachers have told us correctly. But certainly, you have to be very brisk and intense on your path, which is extraordinarily difficult in a pagan-dominated world like we have now. Extraordinarily difficult. So it is not okay for someone, for instance, in church to jump up and disrupt the service. That is not okay. You're breaking everyone's momentum. You know, it is not okay to break momentum for those who are being responsible. It is not okay to dedicate your life to trying to break their momentum. That is most definitely not okay. If somebody wants to break their own momentum, fine. Let them dwell in a place where they're focusing on breaking their own momentum. So there does need to be rules, laws, regulations that prevent this nonsense which is taking place in this world today. It is so bad. I can't even recount some of the stuff that happened today, but it's really vicious, the demand for death from the pagans, from the rebellious spirits, who have no choice but to repent eventually. They're just saying, well, we're going to drag you down into our misery. And I'm saying, no, you're not. So I absolutely support a religious society, which is basically means taking care of business, which means pragmatism. I absolutely support pragmatism, which just happens to call it religion, but it's really just pure pragmatism, which you don't really have a choice about it. You have to do it. So basically I'm saying I support doing what you have to do. That's being very pragmatic, isn't it? I support doing what you have to do. You have to see through the illusion of time, space, form process. You have to see through that, or else you're going to continue to believe in death. You're going to continue to believe in sickness. You're going to continue to believe in suffering. You're going to continue to believe in bodies. You're going to continue to try and search for these crummy crumbs, stale, rotten crumbs of what you think define as happiness. You'll continue to fight with all this conflict in the world. You continue to suffer so terrible in misery. You will continue on with that for sure, without any doubt whatsoever. Nobody wants that. But as Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma said, this world is an insane asylum. She used the word very carefully. This is an insane asylum. Okay. To believe you're in a world at all means you're in really in an insane asylum, so to speak. To believe that there's time, space, form, process at all is insane. So of course those who are dwelling think they're dwelling in a world with bodies and all time, space, it's an insane, they're dwelling in an insane asylum, essentially. It's a matter of talking about it, right? And so in an insane asylum, you have to have therapists there, or else nobody's going to get well. You cannot have the inmates running an insane asylum. They're not going to get well. They're not acting in their own best interest. Pagans are not acting in their own best interest. They don't know how. The unrepentant, still rebellious spirits insisting on continuing this misadventure do not know how to act in their own best interest. Therefore, it is incumbent upon the therapists who have a position of authority in the insane asylum to insist upon certain rules and regulations of the insane asylum so that the insane can actually be benefited and get well, because the insane don't know how to get well. They're totally confused. They're freaked out. They're terrified. They're a mess. And so what's happening in this world is the inmates are gaining control of the asylum. The pagans are getting control of the asylum. And that's a super bad thing to happen. Disastrous. Disastrous. Because they don't act in their own best interests at all. So it is, again, absolutely fair and just and right for those who know what the cure is, what the truth is, to assert rules, regulations, discipline, practices, therapy, for those of us who are suffering from insanity. It is absolutely right and just. And should be seen that way. Should be seen that way. And we should be thankful for it. Instead, the pagans are spitting on it and mocking it and doing everything they can to deride it. And we've got way too much power in the world now. Way too much power. They should not be calling the shots, and they are. They are. That's what Jesus said. The end of the cycle is going to be a very, very upside down. What he's essentially saying is the inmates will get control of the asylum here, which they have. Which they have. It didn't used to be that way. In fact, it used to be that people accepted the restrictions, necessary restrictions of the insane to stop focusing on bodies, stop focusing on entertainment, which is a way of damning with faint praise our true functioning. Stop focusing on form, process, time, space. Be humble. Be humble in your actions. Be humble in your appearance. Be humble in your speech. Be repentant. All of this was accepted in a large extent. And then those who wanted to continue their misadventure began to come to this planet and start studying form and time and space. Oh, this is really cool. Science is really cool. You know, this is where it's really at. This is the foolish. These are the fools. These are those who are on the path of misadventure. There is no form to study. There is no space to study. There's no time to study. There are no things to study, actually, at all. This is a mirage. They're studying a mirage. So they're not helping out at all. But this has infected the world. and the world thinks it's a sign of stupidity or lack of progress to regain these restrictions. But, you know, the whole idea of kosher and the Jewish religion, you know, has to be kosher. They said, look, there's rules and regulations that we have to follow that help our spiritual path, and we have to insist upon them, that sort of thing. And all religions have, the purity of the religion says, look, this is how you deport yourself in your life here in order to take care of business. This is necessary. This helps you. Why is it necessary? It builds momentum. And you will not succeed without momentum. You will not. You will not. The pagans, the way the pagans are structuring things, you cannot succeed on the spiritual path that way. You cannot. So they're basically insisting that everybody continue along with their misadventure. And we're saying absolutely not. Absolutely not. I'm not going to agree to that whatsoever. So Jesus said at the end of the age, he will come back. He left here to prepare a dwelling place for us. And he said he'll take us to that dwelling place. Well, we'll see. We'll see. A Course in Miracles and Journey Beyond Words didn't say anything about that. I don't know why. But we'll just have to see. Meanwhile, we keep realizing that wherever we are, we're always exactly where we've always been, which is whatever we desire to experience is. That's where we are. That's where everyone always is. They're always where, exactly where whatever they desire to experience is. That's where everything is. That's where all is. All is. That's where creation is. That's home. That's where we live. That's where all live. Same place. We all live in the exact same place. Whatever we desire, experience is. Now, a great teacher doesn't come to you unless they know that you're going to succeed. So when Longjumpa came to me, I said, wow, I better really get after this. You know, I said a prayer. I said, you know, I feel like we could use some help here in this world. The inmates are running rampant in this asylum. I says, if there's anyone that wants to help at all, any spirit, any compassion, I'll accept help from anyone. It doesn't matter. I don't know, care who you are, what your tradition, what your name is, whatever. We could use all the help we could get here. And this being that was called in the past Longchenpa, Guru Longchenpa from Tibet, the great Tibetan radical Dzogchen adept, head of the top monastery in Tibet, the top spiritual monastery in Tibet. He was the head abbot or the head of that. You know, this is a heavyweight. He showed up and he introduced himself to me in spirit. I became aware of his presence and I got this pure spaciousness. I suddenly got it. I said, wow. Wow. I hadn't seen that before. Thank you for showing up. He would not have shown up if he didn't know, you know, I'm going to be able to get this. I'm going to be able to get this. And I see that Jesus and Longchenpa, they're talking about the exact same thing. Exactly. 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 So I welcome, you know, that sort of help. I welcome that sort of help. It doesn't supplant Jesus at all because I've spent my familiarity with Jesus, but I'm just saying, hey, it's great that somebody agrees with Jesus. You know, how great is that? That someone from some other traditions, other way, agrees entirely with Jesus. There's total agreement there. Different terminology, etc., but total agreement, obviously. Longchenpa emphasizes this. It's all just mere appearance. It's just all mere appearance. And, you know, wow, there's no such thing as form, really. And this is what is taught at these top monasteries. This is what used to be taught. I mean, we, spirit, those who have repented, have been getting this throughout the ages continuously. It's nothing new. It is nothing new to get these glimpses. This is what happens on the spiritual path. So the spiritual path works. It works. And what we're doing in this world is we are accepting this anything goes pagan greed of like nothing, I should be able to do whatever I want to do and it shouldn't bother you at all. Well, if we were all perfectly enlightened, it wouldn't. But we also realize that there is no you and there is nothing you're doing. It's all mere appearance. So you know, so that's intellectually dishonest of the pagans to try to use that argument. The insane need rules, regulations, discipline, reassurance, support. They have to have that. Religion is necessary. Religion is absolutely necessary. Because it is a tough path to go from insanity to sanity. There's that huge block of the continuity fear in the way. Because we've really forgotten what sanity is. We so much believe and are accustomed to believing in time, space, process, form. You know, we're so accustomed to that, that to realize that none of that has ever existed and never will. You know, it's like, whoa, I've lost my identity. You know, I have no idea what's going on. I'm in total chaos. That's what they fear, you know, even though it isn't. I mean, I just saw this today. I'm not in the slightest bit of chaos. In fact, it's a great relief. Like, wow, that's great. I get it. So the continuity fear is severe. That has to be acknowledged in any situation where a spirit thinks it's dwelling in a world. That means they have a terrible, terrible continuity fear. Therefore, you have to have religion. You have to have these rules and regulations and disciplines and structure, some structure. To get the build the momentum up. You cannot start and stop endlessly. You will eventually quit. And insanity does exactly that. Is you start and then, whoa, stop. It's all whimsical. You don't get anywhere. And this is what I realized. I've been through this. I'm just observing it. I've been observing this path that I've been on. Like an observer too. I'm on the path and I'm also observing it. And I see that just start, stop. Eventually you give up. And you have to decide at some point, hey, no, I've got to really get after this and get it done. And I've got to start being more pragmatic about it. It's like saying, you know, somebody who's had severe surgery or something, and they need a wheelchair for a while. They're not mobile. They need some help for a while. You just can't say, nobody needs a wheelchair. No, they do. And so you have to have religion. You have to have it. And it's very chic today, you know, from the rebellious spirits to, you know, just spit on all that. You can't even wear any symbol to school that shows you belong to any religion whatsoever, you know. They want anything on a shirt. Nothing identifies you. In other words, nothing to remind you in this this pit of vipers to remind you of your discipline, of your necessity, that you have a severe continuity problem. And if you don't keep your momentum, you're going to slide back into that pit of that belief in that there is a pit, actually. It's going to be reinforced that there is some pit of time, space, process, and form, which there isn't. There is no pit. You're not even allowed to remind yourself of this, which is necessary. It's very necessary. Somebody gets in their car, you know, and they've just been bombarded all day by rebellious spirits and all their death-based desire for death, actually. And I'm like, wow. And then they're hanging on their mirror there, you know, is like some religious reminder, like, hey, this is my responsibility. You know, pray, for instance, pray in the name of Jesus Christ. I pray that all this death-based games, delusional death-based game, I pray that this all vaporize from me forever and evaporate and be gone. In the name of Jesus Christ, I make this prayer. In the name of Jesus Christ, not in the name of the Matrix. Okay. It reminds them. We need reminders. We need support. We need all this stuff is absolutely necessary. It is fundamentally, pragmatically necessary. Eventually, you get to the point where your effort is so everyday, like just extreme, that, you know, you may not need this as much support. So a lot of the pagans think that they think they're so advanced, you know, they say, oh, we don't need any of that stuff. We'll just reform it. No, they haven't even started, but they're trying to ape, you know, they're trying to ape those who are really advanced, thinking that means, since they're aping them, that means that they must be advanced too. No, they're not. Haven't even started. So, there absolutely has to be rules, regulations, restrictions. You know, in any situation where the spirits claim they're in some world, which is utterly delusional, that there's some body in a world that's completely delusional, total insanity. So, to get at the continuity fear between that and sanity is so extreme, you have to have gradualism. And gradualism requires a lot of support, because you're going to want to slip back down. So you need to have a society and culture saying, hey, these are the rules and restrictions. And we used to have that, you know, call them Puritans, you know, Puritans, for instance, of Christianity. So look, these are the rules and the regulations. This is how you dress. This is how you address one another. This is the space you have between one another. This is how you worship. This is how you go about your, you know, work. You're humble, you're meek, you know. And all that, you de-emphasize appearance, body, form. You de-emphasize form. De-emphasize, and eventually you say, hey, I'm not really even interested in form. You see? But if you have a pagan world, all they're doing is trying to get you interested in form. Okay? Strengthening your belief in form. And you might think that's cool for a while. But eventually you're going to say, uh-oh, I took the wrong path. Wow, I'm in big trouble now. Because I'm being super manipulated. I feel like I'm out of control. I feel like I've lost my spirit. I don't feel like, what's wrong? Well, you kept emphasizing, kept being attracted to form. Attraction to form is fundamentally an extreme sin. It is extremely ruinous for your momentum, is attraction to form. That is why it's extremely important in society for people to de-emphasize the anything that is attracting, trying to make the form look attractive. Now, there are some times that people will be fanatical about this. There are other times where people will be common sense, pragmatic about it. Okay, so there's different levels, but it always has to be there. It always has to be there. And there are many positive helps that we need along the way. One of them is to knock out entertainment, stay away from entertainment as much as possible. Again, that sours us on our functionality, actually. Sours us. And we say, wow, creativity just really isn't that great. We thought it was really great, but it's not really that great. As again, you go to something and think, oh, it's so wonderful, you know, and then you come home and you realize, wow, it really didn't do anything for me. In fact, I feel even worse than before. It's like, well, and it's gone now, you know, it's gone, it won't come return. I'll never have that concert again. And you start feeling depressed about it, and it's horrible. So you should not de-emphasize entertainment whatsoever. It should be absolutely de-emphasized. The body, attractiveness of the body should be de-emphasized. All this stuff is super, super pragmatic and absolutely very helpful. Very, very helpful. And those rebellious spirits will be certainly on a path of a ruinous path for themselves. So that momentum of that path will bother them greatly. And so they have a tendency to backslide, very much like a drug addict, you know, like an alcoholic. They see that bottle and they just say, wow, I just think just taking a drink right now won't be such a big deal. So it's kind of like if you're like a world full of alcoholics, and you're suffering horribly from this, and you say, this belief in death is killing me, you know, and you say, I've repented. I'm going to stop drinking. Now imagine if in that world that everybody made it a point to plant alcohol wherever you were. That is kind of like what the pagans are doing in this world. The secular humanists, materialists, pagans, the rebellious spirits who insist on continuing their misadventure. Wherever we go in this world, we now, it's kind of like the analogy of the alcoholic. They're planting the bottle right in front of us. In fact, they're coming right up to you and trying to, you know, put the bottle in their mouths and drink, you know. Here, drink. Drink. I had this happen, something like this happened to me today. It was terrible. Pagan, it was just awful, just wicked. And you must have this. Here it is. You can't resist this. You must take this. Imagine if everywhere you go, it's like that. Who among us can keep our momentum under those circumstances as well? Keep our momentum is the operative word. Those who like Long Jempar Jesus or Sri Sri Nanamayama already, well, there is no issue of momentum with them whatsoever. So it's a moot point. You cannot use them as examples for a world. What should we do? Say, well, Jesus doesn't need that. Well, Jesus doesn't need any momentum. He knows very well. He doesn't have any continuity fear whatsoever. But we have a severe problem. Just like, you know, a severe alcoholic says, look, I have a severe problem with going back to drinking, and you're not doing me any favors by pouring a glass of alcohol and drinking it right in front of me. Say, oh, this is so wonderful. I just love this. I feel so great. This makes me feel so wonderful. Here's a glass. Here's some for you. You have some. You're not doing me any favors at all. Is that fair? Is that right and just? If you're trying to lead someone back down and break their momentum, which, you know, is horrible. Is that something that society should tolerate, and not only tolerate, but applaud and support? Which that's exactly the kind of society we have today, that applauds and supports this sort of behavior, because they're insisting that those on the spiritual path are fools and dangerous fools, and they need to be converted back to the pagan ways, which they insist are going to work. There's no possibility of any workage at all. Because there is no such thing as time, space, form, or process. It doesn't exist, never will. They're working with nothing. They're basically saying, well, nothing will work. No, nothing doesn't work. Essentially, that's all they're saying. We're sure that nothing is going to work. It's going to work great for us. That doesn't. No, repentance is what works. Repentance means no longer desiring to be, try to be separate from God, greater than God. That's what works. And then working on the continuity fear is what works. So we are absolutely within our rights to admonish the pagan world and admonish those on the spiritual path to turn your back on the pagan world. Turn your back on them. Do not give them any attention. Shift your attention off the pagan world, the pagan society. Shift your attention off of them. They don't deserve your attention. They absolutely do not deserve. The one who's holding up that glass of alcohol, saying, drink, they don't deserve your attention. They do not deserve your attention because they're trying their best to shift your attention away from the truth. How is that deserving? You can honor them in your heart. You say, look, I honor your decision, but I also honor my decision not to pay you any attention. Don't give them any attention. Don't give pagans any attention. Plain and simple. Just shun them. That's what used to be in this world. The non-religious were shunned. Rightfully so. And of course now they're furious about it. So they say, we're going to turn things around on you. We're going to shun you. So now they're shunning religious people. Or even more so, trying to lead them astray. Trying their very best to lead them astray. So we absolutely do not have to give them the slightest bit of attention. Do not have to talk with them. Do not have to interact with them. Because what are you talking about? They're interacting with a mirage, an insistence that it's real, a denial of reality, insisting that this is truth. There's nothing to interact with there, actually. So until they repent and accept the spiritual path, There's no help you can give to them. There's no help you can give to them. And you just have to refuse to allow them to divert your attention. Remember, in terms of fairness, they're the ones that are being unfair. And so in order to make it fair, you need to stop paying attention to them. You do not have to be friendly to them. You do not have to, because they will use that to engage you. You know, it's like someone said, here, drink this, and you just, you know, turn the other cheek. Pay no attention to them. Go on your way. Okay? Well, whereas if you smile and say, hi, how are you doing? And nice to meet you. And what's going on? Well, I'm a good person. I want to be fair. When they say, well, you got to drink this drink. Look how great. Look how wonderful it is. Here. Drink the drink. This one. Here. Let me press it to your lips. Let me say how wonderful you are. I'll tell you how wonderful you are. As soon as you drink this, you'll be part of the club. Friend with friendships with everybody. You know, this is called, you know, the temptation, satanic temptation of the devil. This is exactly how pagans are. And of course you're placing yourself in a situation where you're likely to drink, thinking, well, I need to please them or something. Now, you cannot please the unrepentant. You cannot never please them. You can never please them. They can't be pleased. Because they want to believe that there's a way to separate from God, and there isn't a way. And they insist that the only way they can ever be pleased is for this to succeed. And it can never succeed. So they're essentially insane. You can't make the insane happy. You have to lead them to happiness. All right? And one of the first ways of leading them to happiness is to shun them. When they misbehave like that, you shun them. You know, most religions, you can't. If you're pagan, you can't get into the church. You have to repent first. And there's various rituals of repentance that you need to go through to humble yourself and say, hey, I have repented, like that. And, you know, in the past, if you are not a member of the, you know, if you have not repented and are working on the spiritual path, then you don't have status in society. Now, you're not completely shunned, but you don't have the kind of status that the pagans crave. They don't have that status. They're most definitely second class, as it were. And no way to get out of that second class unless they repent. There's no way. Now that's all gone to pieces. Now here's another thing. In a world where the structure is so important, an insane asylum, where the therapy is so important to structure it properly, how can you imagine like voting on the structure of an insane asylum and giving the top therapists one vote and the most insane people in the insane asylum one vote, and saying that these votes are of equal value as to what kind of structure there should be, and if there's more people in the insane asylum than there are therapists, that each one should have one vote, and then total it up, and then whatever the decision is, everyone's bound by that. So if the inmates, the insane vote, you know, this is how we want to spend our time, and we're going to vote on it. So we vote and say, oh, you know what, we won the vote, so this is how we're going to structure. Does that make any sense whatsoever, or is that just insanity? It's insanity. It's absolute insanity. So throughout history, the voting was done by those who were responsible and supposedly knew how to structure, more or less. And the ones who were crazy, insane, pagans, value the body, time, space, process, form, it's all important, they didn't get to vote to decide how to structure their experiencing here, which would help lead them to enlightenment, actually. They didn't get an equal vote, equal say. That's crazy. That's the worst thing possible, is to say the insane should have equal say on what their treatment is. They have no idea what their best interests are, actually. They're in fact, just opposite. They're doing everything wrong. And so we have this madness now in this world where we think that one person, one vote is the answer to everything. You know, it's absolute insanity. Absolute insanity. Is they're trying to make everything be based on just voting and have no weight whatsoever on voting, you know. It's just absolutely nuts. It's the inmates taking over the asylum is what's happening here. It's like, what about this, like, you know, some severe plague outbreak? Now, are you going to say, hey, you know what? We need to figure out, like, a cure for this disease, okay? So, we're going to take the people, these people over here who have never studied medicine, who have no idea whatsoever of what a cure even is, or wouldn't have the slightest idea even how to go about this, and then we're going to take this group of researchers who have spent their whole life researching on how to isolate and find out this bug and how to, you know, how to treat illnesses, or experts. And we're going to take a vote between these groups, and we're going to give each one vote, one, all right? And then whatever the way to go about this is voted on, whatever wins the vote, that's what we're going to do. So those who have no clue, you know, will say, hey, why don't we do this? And they win the vote, and it's okay. We're going to say, okay, doctor, sorry, you know, you lost the vote. This is what you have to do. Would anybody in the world go along with that? Anybody with any trace of reason in this world, would they say, oh, sure, that's the way, well, that's how we have to have the world, is let's make sure there's a vote, one person, one vote, on what kind of research we need to do to treat this deadly plague that's spreading like crazy. Oh, let's put the people in charge who don't have a clue what they're doing. Give them that's what we vote on, sure. Nobody in this world would say that. And yet the insane plague that is spreading rapidly throughout this world is paganism, okay, which is rebellious spirits. The spirit of spiritual rebellion is with the deadly plague that is spreading through this world. It's a belief in death is what it is. And so what we're going to give those who don't have a clue how to treat this, we're going to give them equal vote to those who know exactly how to treat this. And when those who know exactly how to treat this get outvoted, then the world's going to say, okay, let's go along with the vote. Utter madness, isn't it? Only the insane could even remotely agree to such a thing. And yet this is exactly what's taking place in the world right now. As if those who don't have a clue, those don't have a clue, the pagans don't have a clue, they're clueless. And yet they want to tell religions how to function. Okay. And the religions do have a clue. There's no question. I've studied my whole life, and they do have a clue, most certainly. It's gotten watered down in various ways throughout the ages, but certainly the rust can be gotten off. They certainly do have a clue. So we're going to have those who don't have a clue tell those who do know the way how to function. That's exactly what we got going right now. And so, does anybody feel good about that? Really, the inmates take over the asylum, and you say, oh, this is great, you know, this is really going to turn out great. We got all these people with PhDs, and, you know, a PhD doesn't mean anything in terms of actually knowing how to treat this insanity. It doesn't. You have to actually have taken the spiritual path and actually seen for yourself, glimpse for yourself the truth of this path. It cannot be academic at all. It cannot be academic. You cannot have academics leading religion. You absolutely cannot. You have to have direct experiencers. Those are the therapists, are those who directly know, directly experience, they have seen, they have confirmed through their own clarity. Absolutely has to be this way, pragmatically, for there to be success. For there to be success, the momentum is all important. Because only if you build up this momentum can you feel like, you know what, I've got so much momentum, I'm going to keep going. I believe I'm going to be able to somehow smooth this out. I don't know how, but I've got the momentum, I'm going to keep going. And by doing that, as I'm doing in these videos to show you it's possible, the seemingly intractable conundrums, smooth out. You are the steamroller. You're smoothing out the road. You know, you just keep going, and you see this big pile of asphalt in front of you. You know, you're just gonna push it and steamroll it. You know, smooth it out. But you gotta have confidence. You gotta have confidence. Say, I know I can do this, and you just keep on trucking. Whereas you let the pagans undermine your confidence and say, hey, look how attractive these bodies are. You gotta believe in bodies because that's gonna make you happy. Then you're gonna lose your confidence. You say, wow, look at that big mountain asphalt there. How the heck am I gonna deal with that? You know? Then you lose your momentum and you don't get it. You have to carry the path through all the way, all the way, all the way. It's an all the way sort of situation. Now, I got an invitation from Jesus to go to his dwelling place. Well, you know, that Jesus knows, hey, you know, you're getting it, you're getting it, you're gonna get it, you're gonna get it. The momentum, you know, the glimpses, it's the momentum's enough that you're gonna keep pushing, keep pushing, keep pushing, keep pushing. But I'm not gonna count my chickens before they're hatched, that is for sure. Stay humble and you know, keep working out even harder. Okay, well, they don't want to get into that. It seems like that's like adding jitters to people. People get jitters over that kind of stuff. They say, well, I'm not ready for that. I'm not ready for that. Well, sure. Sure, but it can happen. It can happen. Didn't bother me in the slightest. I'm not bothered by it at all. And again, only had glimpses. But Jesus tells us the glimpse is enough. He says one glimpse saves you thousands of years of misery. Just one glimpse of the formless. Like to see form, to get a glimpse of formlessness, or to recognize. Yes, this is true. And the glimpse is subtle, you know, it's subtle. It's subtle. But it's enough. It's enough. You don't have to just simply cast aside, you know, and just be completely elated forever. It's enough for your momentum to get this glimpse. So don't be looking for some huge breakthrough in terms of, wow, I'm just like flooded with joy. And it's overwhelming, it's overflowing, and it's just, you know, well, don't look for that. Because it's not likely, you're not likely to get it right now. But keep working, keep working, keep working, and you'll find that these glimpses arise. You'll suddenly say, wow, it all clicks together. This is true. This is all just appearance. And then you'll feel, oh my gosh, that's so heavy, that's just like too much. But, you know, then you just sort of feel this reaction to it, and then you're able to get used to the reaction and make it less and less and say, okay, it's not okay, and let it calm down. And that's what you do. You get a glimpse, the reaction comes, you let it calm down. You get another glimpse, the reaction comes, you let it calm down. This is called evaporating the continuity fear. You have to get that glimpse. And the glimpse can be very subtle. It's just somehow you just feel like this is true. Just for a moment. You just feel for a moment like, you know what? I'm okay with that. I'm okay with it being true. Just for a moment you feel like, that would be okay with me. I agree with that. And then, whoo, you know, what did I just do? I just agreed, you know? Or I stepped out of the agreement of the matrix, actually. I agreed to stop pretending to be something that I'm not. And then you're kind of shaky after, so, oh my gosh, you know, what's going to happen to me? And you let that calm down, and then you get another subtle glimpse, let that calm down. This is therapy. This is therapy. This is what you have to do. You can't get it intellectually. That's not therapy. That's what the pagans do. They think it's all just, all religion is some kind of academic thing that can be grasped academically. And so they say, sure, I went to some, you know, place, and I studied theology there, and I got a PhD, I have a PhD in theology, so what are you trying to tell me, you know, where are your annotations? Okay, that's nothing, that's nothing. doesn't do anything. You have to actually feel in your being. Like I felt, but was that today or yesterday? Today. I think it was today. All is being. Yeah, then another. I realized all is being. Right here, right now, all is being. Right here, right now, this is being. Right here, right now, all is being. I was like, whoa. Okay. Let me keep driving. How did I get that? There's this truck. And I looked at the truck. I'll be like at a stoplight or something. I looked at this truck and I said, all be. That was the name of the truck or something, the company, all be. And I said, suddenly, all is being. Right now, all is being. This is being right now. All is simply being right now. And it's just like, whoa. There's something, something said, I can accept that. I can accept it. All is being. There's just all there is right now. All this is being here now. This is it. So I just kept driving. And it's wow. Okay. And, you know, I went about my work and settled down a little bit. So, see, that's more than academic, right? It's not academic. It's a level at the level of acceptance, saying, you know what, I can accept this. I accept this. The level of being. I accept that all is being here, right now. This is all. This is. This is the experience of my desire right now. I am experiencing my desire. What I desire to experience is, and this is it. And this is appearance in being, in pure spaciousness, and that's all it is. It's only being. There's no time, space, process, or form whatsoever here. It is simply being, appearance being, isness being. That's all there is. That's it. That's it. And so you feel that a little bit. It's not overwhelming feeling, really. Maybe that comes later. You know, gradually you can handle it greater and greater, you know. Bit by bit. It's gradualism. Gradualism. That's the path. That's the path. It's not getting a PhD at one of those great institutions of higher learning where you can put, you know, 500 footnotes in your book that you wrote about being. And no, just look at that truck. It says all be. I said, oh my, all is being. Yes. All is just being. That's it. This is all being. There's no form. There's no time. There's no space. No duration, location. This is solid being. One solid block of being. That's it. Yeah. No annotations to that. Reality doesn't need any annotations. So now, what's going to happen with the pagans and the insane asylum? What's going to happen with this insane asylum? I don't know. For sure. I don't know what's going to happen with this insane asylum, because there's trouble in this insane asylum. Maybe the therapist may actually need to, for example, free speech movement, the students took over the institutions. Okay, all right. Not judging that, I'm just using that as an example. And they basically occupied the chancellor's, the dean's office, and you know, they barricaded, the administration couldn't function. They took over the university's administration, couldn't function, they couldn't get into their offices or anything. What did they do? You know, they said, well, we'll stay at home for a while, until it cools down. No class for right now. Yeah, what can you do? Let's negotiate, let's calm down. Eventually they went back and said, hey, you know what, we're gonna get back to studying here. So we may need, like administrators, to See, I stayed home for a while. Stayed home for a while. Let it calm down. Let it calm down. It goes, sort of a short break. Short break, short vacation. Some way to sidestep and just, take refuge somewhere. Take refuge for a short while. For a short while. Now, short to the Holy Spirit is what? You know, what does that mean? I have no idea what short is. Days, weeks, years, millennia, I don't know. A short while. Maybe, I don't know, years could be a few years, or I don't know, something possible. But short, not forever. That's what I've gotten. That's the best that I can tell you right now, is taking refuge for a short while. Just like the administration of a university, they can't function, they can't get in their office, they can't do anything. And then there's standoff, the police are there, SWAT teams, the students are barricaded, you know. They say, hey, we're staying here as long as, and they might stay there for months. They barricade themselves in, trying to shut down the whole, you know, cycle of the school year and everything. So the inmates here, the pagans, will, you know, may gain control of this planet and try to shut it down and prevent any religious functioning on this planet. Make it so chaotic and so horrible, nobody can really give their attention. You know, and nobody can develop momentum, which is all important. Again, I get back to momentum. This is the crucial, crucial area of your spiritual path, is momentum. Without it, you're going to fail. So the whole pagan plan is to bust up this momentum. This is their plan, is to bust it up. They're not saying, oh, you can't think about religion or something, but they're gonna do everything they can to bust your momentum. Because religion is all about momentum. It means you get more involved, and more involved, and more involved, and more time, and more time, and more effort, and you become super focused on it. And the pagans say, no, you can have your religion once a week, but that's it, you know. They put severe restrictions on it, so you cannot really produce any momentum. This is their goal. This is their goal. And of course, they'll say, no, we didn't do anything wrong. We're totally fair here. We just put reasonable restrictions. We don't want any fanatics here, you know. They view all religion as fanatics. They take the worst examples of those who are very insane and have maybe failed at religion, or they're examples of inmates taken over the asylum, actually, who say, we can do religion better than you can, and then so they go around killing everybody and they go crazy and stuff. And then the pagans use that as an example and say, you see, all religion's terrible, let's get rid of all of it. It's that kind of thing. That's like getting somebody drunk, falling down drunk, and then putting him in a car and then having him drive and get in an accident, and then saying, you see, we should ban all cars. Cars are dangerous. We don't want anyone driving cars. You know, idiocy. That's what happens when you hang out with fools, is you become, you know, you spout idiocy. So, you know, they're trying to use the worst possible examples to try to shut it all down, or really forge a deal, which they love to do, knowing that deals are momentum breakers. Okay, pagans are very shrewd at deals, and their deals are always aimed at breaking momentum, breaking your momentum, which will cause you to fail, for sure, for sure. You cannot succeed without momentum. So you have to watch your momentum like it's the most important, more important than water. You know, you have to choose between drinking water and keeping your momentum. You'll choose keeping your momentum, for sure. If I got to choose between sleep and keeping my momentum, is keeping my momentum. If I can't sleep, so be it. But if I lose my momentum, I am cooked. I am cooked. I am really cooked. So, yeah. I mean, if I have to die, I mean, that's why religious people, they choose between losing their momentum and dying. They choose dying, well, losing their body, for so to speak, this appearance. They choose. That's why there have been so many, like, for instance, Christian martyrs, is they say, hey, I'm not going to lose my momentum. That's more important than this body form. It's more important to me. Well, that's awesome, actually. Yeah. You would hope that they would pray to the Holy Spirit and in Jesus' name, and find a way that they can keep their momentum going without, you know, losing this, you know, appearance here. You know, that should work also. You'd like to think so, right? Yeah. I certainly feel that way. You know, hey. And plus, don't put your quote-unquote death on somebody else's conscience. They're crazy, the pagans. Crazy just reinforces their belief in death, you know? Just reinforces it, actually, in a lot of ways. They say, well, they died very nobly. Okay, that's pretty cool. Maybe I can die nobly, too. But still, it reinforces the delusional belief in time, space, form, and process, which doesn't exist. Doesn't exist. Again, it's only a agreement to sequence appearances in a certain way to give the presumption of it. Like, I want this appearance of a table to be an appearance of the table now, and I want the appearance of the table now, and I want it to be the appearance of the table now, and I want to continue to be the appearance of the table now, and now, and now, and now, and now, and now, and now, forever, you know, kind of thing. Yeah, like that. It's still not a table, it's just an appearance. It's not a thing, it's not a form. It has no duration. It has no location or duration. You can say, I want this appearance of appearance here look like a table to be here, right? This location, this moment. And I want this moment to be appear as a table at this location at this moment, forever and forever and forever. There's still no time, space, form, or process at all. Because the next moment you can say, oh, I want this to be an ocean. Flowing endlessly in all directions. And that's what you'd be experiencing. So there's no such thing. There's no thingness. That's why you cannot define reality. There is no process, form, time, space. It's impossible. You can't define. You say, that's a table. No, just this moment, you have an appearance that you want to be experiencing. Next moment, you could be experiencing anything else. Right? There is no linkage between moments at all. There is no linkage, no process, no time, no space, no form. So, this may all be like, whoa, what is this? You know, I might be thinking, what is this? What is it? What is he talking about? But just a while ago, I wouldn't be able to talk like this. What happened? Momentum happened. How do you get momentum happen? Every day, put your all into it. How do you do that? Well, you got to be skillful in your pragmatism and manage your success. Manage your success. Be humble. Continuity fear. Accept you have a sphere of continuity fear. Manage your success. And realize that the alternative to failure, the alternative is failure. And been there, done that, right? Don't want to go back to that. Don't want to go back to being an inmate in the asylum, right? Absolutely not. Absolutely not. And this should, as people said, this puts the fear of God in people, so to speak. The fear of God just means that you can fail to realize God and be right back as an inmate again. And that's something. If that doesn't frighten you, nothing will, and it certainly does frighten you. Once you have gradually realized there is no pit, there are no layers and levels, no layers, no levels, no time, no space, no form, no process, you say, well, I don't want to go back into believing there's a pit there, believing that I'm in this pit, believing that I got to struggle through all these layers and levels, time, space, form, and process, infinite conflict, infinite fear, infinite insecurity, infinite despair. I don't want to. Are you kidding me? You know, that puts, you know, this, like, shock. No way. Called putting the fear of God in you. Not that God is fearful, you understand. But you understand what they're getting at here. Fear of losing God. Hey, the fear of losing God should really be shock treatment for you. Losing your clarity. There is no pit. There is no pit of time, space, form, process, layers, and levels. There is no such thing at all. It doesn't exist. It does never exist. It can never exist for anyone. Impossible. Everyone is free. Everyone is still exactly as God created them to be. Whatever they desire to experience is, that's it. That is the true for all, without any exception whatsoever. Not a single exception whatsoever. That's the vision of oneness. See this. So you want that. You want to stay with that. You want to stay, you know, keep working for that, keep working for that. Because the alternative is horrible. The Babylonian attitude has got this world terrible. The horrors of Babylon, the whole attitude of the horrors of Babylon is here. And it's atrocious what's going on in the world, truly atrocious. And that's, you know, it's like everybody's screaming. It's like you're this group sitting on the ground, and everyone except one is screaming, moaning, crying, going through all this. What's the matter? Like, I'm in this huge pit. There's all these layers and levels and time, space, form, process. I'm having such a horrible time. Help! I don't know how to deal with all this stuff. You know, and you're sitting there, and you say, there is no pit. What are you talking about? There's no pit. Whoa, what do you mean? You don't want to help us? Come on down and help us, you know. Where are you? I can't find you in this pit. You know, where are you? You know, and gradually that insanity can get into you. It can get into you, and they start convincing you that you're there too, where they think they are. There is no there there. There is no there there. So for sure, we're all very prone to being pulled back into delusion. And so we absolutely have to protect ourselves from the pagan mentality. We have absolute right to protect ourselves from the pagan mentality. We have absolute rights to that. And they have absolute right to keep on screaming and telling, hey, you're not helping us, or we can't find you, blah, 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 blah. Okay, they're gonna do that anyway. They're not gonna stop doing, you know, their fear is not gonna stop. They're not gonna stop acting out their fear. Of course they will. They have a right to believe they're in a pit if they want to. I have a right to know there isn't, it's impossible. And avoid the temptation to think it is possible. So we have every right to avoid temptation. And remember, we're on a path of a continuity fear, which God does recognize, the Holy Spirit recognizes, Jesus recognizes the continuity problem. And it's a pragmatic situation. We have every right to be pragmatic with this. In fact, it's insisted upon. We have no option but to be pragmatic with this. We have to succeed, therefore we have to be pragmatic. And so it's very, totally pragmatic to avoid the temptation, to stay away from the temptation as much as possible. So if that means shifting to some other situation, we'll do that. If it means whatever it takes to avoid this temptation is what we need to do, whatever it takes. And we're not going to do anything. Nobody is being called anything stupid. You know, acting out some pagan stupidity. Of course not. We work pragmatically, spiritually. Nobody should lose their body, you know, in this sort of attempt at all. That's foolishness, total foolishness. Because there isn't a body. So what are you doing trying to lose it? So you say, well, I just got to get rid of this body. What do you mean there is no body? That's not spiritual saying, I got to get rid of this body. I got to get rid of this form. There is no form. So forget about trying to get rid of it. Spiritually, this is to say, look, this is just an appearance, all the same as all appearances. Okay. What we need is to maintain whatever it is that we're believing at this point, but distance ourselves from the temptation to lose our momentum is what we see. It's a momentum factor. We're pragmatically, what helps our momentum? Stay away from the wrong kind of crowd. Stay away from the wrong sort of temptations. That's what helps our momentum. So again, we have every right to be pragmatic. That is being fair to everyone. Because the therapist maintaining their therapeutic capability is fair both to the therapist and to the inpatients who need the therapy. It's fair to everyone. Just because the insane say it's not fair doesn't mean it's not fair. Because the insane don't know what their own best interests are. So it is fair to the insane to avoid the temptation that they offer. You know, that's totally fair. That's total compassion. That is love. It's the right path. It's the right thing to do. And we need to keep reminding ourselves of this. Absolutely. Not doing the insane any favors by agreeing with their insanity. Not doing them any favors whatsoever. And there's sometimes when the insane go on rampages. We know this. Individually, sometimes individuals do this, and collectively, that sure happens collectively too. There are also false flags. There have been many false flags in history to pull a nation into war, as a matter of fact. That is fact. Usually the case. That's great for the profiteers, war profiteers, etc., right? It's an insane asylum here. So don't be tempted to believe there is any such thing as a world. Right? Don't be tempted to believe that. Now, you might be saying, well, I get it, and I know I can get it more, but I don't want to be the temptation to lose my momentum, you know, is very strong in this world. It absolutely is. It absolutely is. Where can you go? You know, I don't want to stop taping, because where do I go? You know, where can I go to get this sort of encouragement? You know, just journey beyond words, long jhampa, spaciousness, radical teachings of Dzogchen. What is this? The radical Dzogchen teachings of the Vajra heart, pure spaciousness or something. Where do I go? It is tough. I look on the internet. Where do you find it? So, I don't like to stop taping, really. Because then I have to go back and what am I going to focus on? It's tough. Very tough. There's some content that can be helpful. You can find some, yeah. If you really dig for it. So there are times when the insane go on rampages. Sometimes you just have to back off and say, okay, let's not turn this into a full-fledged fight here. Let's not alienate them, you know. In other words, school administration, let's not alienate the students even more. They're already very alienated. Let's not force the issue. Let's let them feel as if they're running the university for a while, because that's what they want to feel. And then they'll find out how inept they are at it. And they're going to say, wow, you know, we're not very good at this. I think we need the administration back in place. And we need to make some changes, adjustments, and say, okay, let's negotiate. And finally, you know, the negotiations happen. There's some changes, and et cetera. And the administrators who know their business get back, and things start running smoothly again. So basically, the inmates want to take over this world, this asylum. All right, let them take over for a while. Let them find out how absolutely inept they are. Okay. And then they're going to start thinking, whoa, everything's getting so much worse. This is horrible. What are we doing? We're idiots. Help, you know, help. We need some therapists back. What's going on here? Then the therapist can return and say, okay, look, let's get back to business here, you know, and let's work on, get better clarity here. I mean, I do see that there's been a lack of clear teaching in this world. It certainly isn't easy to disseminate any teaching in this world. It is really clear because the people have such an aversion to it. But we do need to. It's tough because the pagan mind under this matrix, the mind spins off into so many different directions. So many compromises, you know, as if there's some compromise with truth, as if truth needs to compromise with lies, you know. Say, well, okay, this is form sometimes, and it's not form to other times. And in this state, it's form, and in that state, it's not form, and blah 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 blah. Nonsense. It's all nonsense. And so it's tough. I don't know. I will have to do a better job in the future, see how it goes. You know, absolutely. But progress can be made. When you really deal with it on a cultural level, you can build momentum up. But the key is you have to keep going. You can't stagnate. You gotta keep going. That's all important. All right. So we made a big push here. We make a big push every day, try to. It's all about momentum. It's keeping your momentum going. When you keep your momentum going, you will realize for sure, you'll say, hey, this is working. And don't freak out. Don't freak out. Because you go along, the more insights and breakthroughs you have, and the more momentum keep going, the easier it is. The easier it becomes, actually. You say, oh yeah, today I realize all is being, there is no form, and on, you know, oh, okay. Yeah, another day, it's great. Nice progress today.